Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private?
Yes.
Thank you. Our second agenda item is to continue our evidence session on the Legislative Consent Memorandum for the Retained EU Law Revocation and Reform Bill. And this morning we are joined by Isabel Mercer, Senior Policy Officer of ISPB Scotland, David Mackay, Head of Policy, Scotland Soil Association, Professor Colin Reid, UK Environmental Law Association, Lloyd Austin, Governance Group Convener of the Scottish Environment Link, David Bowles, Chair, Trade and Animal Welfare Coalition, and David McKenzie, Chair of the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland. And a warm welcome to you all, and apologies for, as you can tell, not in best form today with the cold. We have three general themes to cover this morning, which we hope to kind of stick to, but as these things go with a round table, it can be a bit more free-flowing. So please just indicate to myself or to the clerks if you want to come in a particular question, and hopefully we'll have enough time to cover everything this morning. So I'd like to start with an opening question around, just if you could provide, not in too much detail, because thank you as well for all the written submissions, but just an overview of your own impact assessment of the bill, and particularly in relation to the regulated environment in which they operate, and the potential impact of relevant standards and protections in devolved areas, and how this will affect impact on trade and business. So if I could maybe go around the table from left to right, and bring in first Professor Reid.
Right, good morning. Thank you for the invitation to be here today. I think it's obvious to everybody that this bill will have a huge effect if it comes into force, that so much of our regulatory law in so many areas is dependent on EU measures. And to add to that, you have the uncertainty about what's actually going to be affected, partly because we don't know what the UK government is going to want to maintain, continue and keep going, partly because of the complexity of the actual legislation, that when you look at the regulatory framework within Scotland, you have delegated legislation that was made under the powers of both the European Communities Act and domestic legislation. So trying to work out which bits are going to be affected or not is itself a problem. In the environmental area, which I work in, so much of our law over the last 40 years has been shaped by EU law, and it's a hugely complicated, integrated patchwork of domestic legislation, EU legislation. The two have worked together. Up until the past summer, there are still measures being made in London that rely on the retained law and new law working together, and that's all going to go. The timescale is incredibly short for trying to sort out what was going to happen. It's completely against the decision that was taken when Brexit was decided on, that the only sensible way was to have continuity and then, at leisure, as and when needed, review different areas, decide what's right for Britain in the new world. And picking up from the written submissions, I think just perhaps the one thing that's perhaps underplayed in all of those is the impact of losing the certainty of European case law. That the court decisions from the European Court are so important in making certain frameworks laws work. So even if the text of the legislation stayed the same, the fact that the interpretations could, not necessarily would, but could change, adds a whole extra layer of uncertainty. So I think uncertainty is the big message in capital letters, that if we knew exactly what was going to be affected, if we knew the policy direction that was going to be taken on various things, it would help. But we don't even know that.
Thank you. Ms. Mercer?
Yeah, morning, everyone. And I'd just like to say thanks for the opportunity to come and provide evidence today. So as set out in our written submission, RSPB Scotland is deeply concerned about this bill, which has major implications for a whole range of environmental laws and protections for nature in Scotland, as well as many of the other areas that have been spoken about to the committee already. So we see this bill as creating a legislative cliff edge for thousands of laws, including key laws protecting nature. And I guess I'd like to kick off my remarks today by just stating that RSPB's position is we think that the approach in the bill is so unworkable and undeliverable in the timescales set out in the bill that we would actually like to see the UK government withdraw this bill and come forward with a different, more consultative, more sensible approach to reviewing and amending and improving environmental laws. So I think it's important just to state that, as has been spoken about often by Greener UK, which is a coalition of environmental organisations that are engaging strongly with this bill at the Westminster level, we are not opposed to improving and reviewing and updating environmental laws, but it's just that, as Colin was setting out just now, the approach in the bill presents such a high level of risk and uncertainty, particularly given the sunset provisions and the deadline provided there, that we feel that a new approach to looking at rule is needed at this stage. So I'll finish there for now, but we can come back to further detail throughout the session.
Thank you. Mr. Bowles.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chairman, and thank you for inviting me up. I was fortunate, if that's the right word, to give evidence to the Bill Committee in Westminster, and the RSPCA was very clear alongside Greener UK and Wildlife Link that our best option is to scrap the bill, if not pause it, if not look at what the deadlines are, because that is a huge cliff edge. If you're looking for certainty from the UK government, I'm afraid you won't get it. And I think there are two major issues that the Scottish government should be really looking at. The first is what is devolved and what is not devolved. So the RSPCA and TORC have gone through the 44 different pieces of legislation, and in our submission we have written down what we think is devolved. I'm not a lawyer, that is my subjective opinion, and you will not get any guidance from the UK government on that. And the difficulty for the Scottish government, obviously, is that the deadline is next December, so you only have 13 months to do this. And then your right to have retained EU law will disappear, and the UK government will act for you. They were very clear in Bill Committee last week that they will not change that deadline, but they will act for the Scottish government. And I think that is a very dangerous precedent, not just for animal welfare legislation, but for devolution itself. And they are trampling all over the Sewell Convention. Finally, just to give you a few examples of where I think this could really interact, not just with animal welfare legislation, but to be honest, with the trade and cooperation agreement with the EU, there are pieces of legislation in there. For instance, will the UK government retain the beef hormone ban, which they've said that is set in law? Well, it may not be set in law if it falls under this sunset deadline. And obviously, the EU has a ban on importation of beef with hormones. And if the UK government is doing trade agreements with the USA, Mexico, both of whom, and Canada, both of whom have beef hormone in production, that is going to rip up the TCA. Another issue which is possibly more relevant to Scotland is the ban on the battery eggs situation. I was involved in bringing that ban in at the EU level in 1999. That deadline went into 2012, so we've had 10 years of having a ban on the barren battery cage. That ban was brought in because of public demand, but we could again see that slip because the UK government is so intent on doing something which is so political in this, which is changing the sovereignty of the EU legislation, and that really worries us. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. McKenzie.
Thank you, Chair, and thanks for inviting me along today to speak. I'm here to speak for Trading Standards, which is the general regulator, if you like, in terms of fairness and safety in buying and selling. We're a local authority function, so over 30 teams across Scotland, and my organisation, Scots, tries to bring that together, coordinate and support and try and have a sort of coherent approach to the work, which I think we're able to do quite well. I mean, like others today and at previous sessions, our main fear in this is the sunset clause. We would say that it risks the loss of vital protections, and there just simply is nowhere near enough time to go through everything between now and next December. And we would point from our position, you know, on the ground in our local communities doing our daily work, we would emphasise that there's a real threat here to those local communities, to consumers, but also to reputable businesses who are also set to lose from this potentially, it seems to us. I think the whole concept and process, as again, as other colleagues have said, seems problematical to us. You know, it seems to me that, for example, we could get significant changes to law here, which without any kind of real impact assessment or scrutiny of any kind. But I'm probably going to leave those sorts of issues to other people today. I think what I can do today is bring maybe a flavour of the variety and the widespread impact of this, you know, in our local communities in terms of the range of topic areas that are covered. Very briefly, in the devolved sphere, it's mostly the sort of interrelated issues of animal feed and animal health and welfare, particularly in terms of the sort of farm-to-fork process. So we're talking about the keeping of animals in holdings, we're talking about transportation, we're talking about slaughter, that sort of thing, and safety and fairness, quality issues in terms of animal feed and so on. So a great big interrelated series of laws there, which our guys are you know, work on daily in our local areas. At one or two other areas, animal disease control partly, one or two areas around human health, one or two areas around environmental protection as well. But I think, and while I appreciate we need to concentrate today on devolved matters for obvious reasons, I think it's important for me at some point to make the point about most trading standards law is reserved, and a lot of the really fundamental impacts that this will have in our localities in Scotland is from the potential loss of some of those reserved laws. So we're talking about, I mean, you'll see it in our written submission, you know, weights and measures, general sort of fair trading, online buying rights, intellectual property, which is a really important thing for protecting our businesses as well as our consumers. You know, just everything that underpins the consumer world, certainly, but beyond that into industrial areas as well. Very, very widespread potential impact of this, if the sunset, you know, with the sunset clause coming so soon. And I want, final point for now, I wanted to just bring out something that I think that Professor Reid touched on here, and it's the interrelatedness of all this. You know, while there are a minority of the things we do are devolved, well, there's some very important things, but a minority of things, they're impacted upon by the by the reserve stuff and also by the non-retained EU stuff. So all this law works together. And a very quick example, single-use vapes. These things, I don't know, these things caught us by surprise in the last year or so. Some real problems with these products. Some of them are unsafe. They're certainly not suitable for children, but they've been sold to children. A lot of work going on by our guys up and down the country on this. And we're using reserved laws, we're using devolved laws, we're using retained EU law, we're using non-retained EU law to be effective in that space, you know. And that's a really important point to make. And one final point. As others have said, we're not against change here. We're absolutely not against change. And there are some retained EU laws that we absolutely think could be improved. And we'll participate in that. But 12, 13 months is not long enough to go through whatever, however many thousand pieces of legislation it is. Okay,
thank you. Mr. Austin. Oh, sorry, Mr. Mackay, sorry.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the committee for the opportunity to come and put forward the views of Soil Association today. To provide a wee bit of context for my opening remarks, it's worth pointing out that Soil Association is a membership charity. We were founded in 1946, and among the founding principles were all about the production of good, nutritious food for all, which was produced with care for the natural world. Now, that mission is as true today as it was more than 75 years ago, and in the intervening decades, we have worked with others to campaign for more sustainable methods of food production, and that has included, where appropriate, legislation and regulation. For example, we helped develop the first standards for organic production, which are underpinned in law, what was EU law and has now been taken over as retained EU law. So we absolutely share the concerns of the others who have already given evidence today, particularly the environmental organisations. So I won't repeat what has been said so far, but the one thing I would emphasise is that we have no objection to a sensible process of examining, of updating or improving existing law. We just don't think that this bill delivers that. as it's currently drafted. In our evidence submission, we've gone in and pulled out specific examples, and there are many hundreds of examples that we could point to, and we've grouped these around pesticides, animal welfare, organic production, as I mentioned, GMOs, and consumer protection. And to take just one example for a moment around organic production, we're in contact with DEFRA on a regular basis, and our understanding is that 200 of the 576 pieces of legislation that have already been identified, and important to note that's potentially not all of them, are being looked at by DEFRA's organic unit. So despite assurances that we have had from DEFRA that the organic regulation itself will be maintained, we remain very concerned about the implications in terms of resource and capacity for looking at such an enormous volume of legislation in a relatively short period of time. But also, it's not just about the organic regulation. There are all sorts of what are termed as horizontal regulations that cross-cut and are referred to within the organic regulation, and these cover a whole range of areas, including water quality, animal welfare, payments for sustainable systems, as an example. So it's important to remember when we start thinking about pulling on individual threads, there are all sorts of other areas which are interconnected. But I'll leave it at that for now, and obviously we can have continued discussion.
Thank you. Finally, Mr. Austin, sorry.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you again for that. Like the other witnesses, for the opportunity to talk to you today. Scottish Environment Link is a forum for Scotland's voluntary environment movement. We have over 40 member bodies, and the governance group, which I'm the convener of, tends to focus on the roles of public institutions and legislation and environmental law in addressing environmental issues. And therefore, that group of NGOs has been the one that has commented on and sought to influence the Brexit process, as well as other kind of institutional and governance matters. And so that's why this bill falls within our remit within the link process. Like the other speakers, we are very concerned about this bill. We think it's very high risk to our environmental standards, because we think it's in a sense deregulatory by design, but it's not deregulatory in a thought out manner. It's deregulatory in an indiscriminate manner, if I might put it that way, in as much as everything is lost unless it's retained, rather than the other way around. And that is a very big risk. And it's particularly contradictory to the Scottish Government's policy of keeping pace with environmental standards, and therefore we're concerned that there's a potential there for that to be that commitment to be undermined. I think I would endorse what everybody else has said about the uncertainty and the complexity of the challenge that would face the UK government and the Scottish government and the Welsh and Northern Ireland governments in dealing with the various reviews that they'd need to do in the timescale mentioned. I mean, the Secretary of State said yesterday in the House of Lords that DEFRA, the Environment Department of the UK government, has identified over 1,000 pieces of environmental legislation that they would need to review. Now, we know that their estimates, if you look at the UK government's dashboard, are incomplete. They don't assess which are reserved and which are devolved. And just the other week, they discovered another tranche of 1,000 across all government, not just the environment. So there's clearly a lot of uncertainty and complexity in this area, that, and therefore the scale of the task and the resources that would need to be devoted to that task are immense. And devoting those resources to that task would be a total distraction from both governments' priorities to address the environment and the climate crisis in the way that they're trying to. I think I would end on two points. First of all, highlighting the interconnectedness that everybody else has commented on, both with reserved environmental law with other aspects of UK legislation. And also, I would finish by saying that, like others, we're not opposed to the sensible process of review and improvement. You know, I think when there have been reviews of environmental law, like the EU-led fitness checks, or indeed UK and Scottish government reviews, those processes are constructive, involve stakeholders, etc., and reach sensible conclusions. And that's the way to go forward in terms of reviewing and making revisions, rather than a sort of blanket revocation and a panic process by which you determine which you keep and which you don't. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I want to open for questions from members. Members may direct questions to specific people, but please, if you do want to come in on a topic, just indicate and we'll try and include everybody. And I'll invite Ms. Boyack first.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I thank the witnesses for all the written evidence we've had in front of us today, which has been really helpful. I want to explore some of the issues there. In the last couple of weeks, we've heard about lack of clarity, uncertainty, complexity with what happens with the cliff edge here in terms of legislation and impacts on producers and businesses. And everybody mentions environment, but can we get some examples? I think you talked to David McKenzie about the impact on communities. I was thinking of maybe going first off to RSPB, to Isabel. Just give us examples. In your submission, you've talked about Habitats Directive, air quality, water quality. Others have talked about chemicals. Can you say how that will actually impact on us? What legislation is potentially at risk here?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there's probably two key issues I'd want to raise here, and actually some context to start off is just to remind all of us that we already know we're in a nature and climate emergency, and that this is a really critical juncture for nature. And so it's actually deeply frustrating that we're talking about kind of fighting for keeping some of our existing effective protections when we should actually be looking to build on those at the moment and restore nature at scale. So I think in terms of the impact of this on Scotland's ability to do that and deliver on its welcome ambitions to restore nature, there's two key things. So one, as has already been mentioned, is some of the resource implications, the knock-on impact that that will have upon the planned legislative timetable for key pieces of legislation, such as the Natural Environment Bill, which is due to come forward at the end of 2023 or the beginning of 2024, which is going to contain crucial nature recovery targets, basically to be the equivalent of Scotland's net zero targets, but for nature. So the resource implications and the capacity and the knock-on implications that will have are huge, as has been mentioned. But then in terms of some of the specific areas of regulation we're concerned about, so when it comes to protections for wildlife, as you mentioned, the habitats regulations are some of are basically our best wildlife protection. So these are regulations that protect our best wildlife sites and also vulnerable species, and include environmental assessment of plans and projects that could potentially affect those important wildlife sites. And just to give the committee a bit of a flavour of some of the complexity here, in Scotland there's actually three habitats regulations that apply. So we have the Conservation of Natural Habitats Regulations 1994 as amended. So these are devolved Scottish regulations that cover the terrestrial environment in Scotland. But then secondly, there's the Conservation of Habitats and Species Regulations 2017. Those are UK regulations, and they do actually apply in Scotland under some circumstances, because for energy consents, for energy generating stations over 50 megawatts, those UK regulations apply in looking at potential impacts on wildlife sites on land. And then thirdly, we have the offshore, what are known as the offshore habitats regulations, which look at the potential impact of marine activities, plans and projects on important wildlife sites in the marine area. So that gives the committee a flavour of the fact that even if the Scottish Government chose to basically restate the Scottish habitats regulations and move those over onto the statute books as assimilated law, which is what we assume would happen given the Scottish Government's welcome commitments to maintain or exceed EU environmental standards, there would still be a potential gap there if the UK government didn't choose to restate the UK habitats regulations. So that's just one of the areas where we're particularly concerned about some of the impacts here.
Okay, thank you. And we heard from the Soil Association you had concerns. Can you say a bit more about kind of water quality and pesticides, what impact that actually has if we lose some of this regulatory or legal environment?
Yes, thank you. As we said in our written submission around pesticides, so many of the most fundamental laws on pesticides are derived from the EU. So, for example, the maximum residue levels, which establish the maximum concentration of pesticide residues that can be permitted in food, and that applies both to animal and human consumption. And obviously those are vital to ensuring food safety. We also have rules such as the plant protection products regulations, so that's setting out requirements for the safe use, storage and handling of pesticides. That incidentally also includes a requirement for the UK government to produce a national action plan on pesticides, which is aimed at achieving a sustainable use. But I think it's worth pointing out as well that, you know, organisations like ourselves are quite often asking governments to go further. And many of the regulations that we have, in our view, don't actually go far enough. So, as an example, the Scottish Government is currently consulting on a new agriculture bill. And within that, we are making, within our response, we're making the argument for an enhanced regulatory baseline. We are making the case for targets to be included within the bill for reductions in pesticide usage. And we are unsure at this stage and unclear as to what this means for the environmental ambitions of the Scottish or Welsh governments. I think others have made this point already. And perhaps Professor Reid might be able to elaborate on this. I think he did in a recent blog that we cited in our evidence. But does this in fact create a regulatory ceiling for the devolved administration? So that's another concern that we have. And to pull out one other example, around GMOs. So if you go through the UK government dashboard, and obviously others have already made the point that it is incomplete, so it's difficult to form a clear view, but you know, immediately you can see there are a number of pieces of legislation that relate to GMOs, and again, these are mostly EU derived. And some of the regulations, for example, Regulation 1830 provides a framework for traceability for products that consist of or contained genetically modified organisms, as well as food or feed that's been produced from GMOs. So we're very concerned about that because the traceability is absolutely vital, and that applies in cases where products may have to be withdrawn. We need to know what's out there and what's in the chain, and also for the monitoring of the potential impacts or effects of these products on animals and the environment. So that also applies to labelling, so accurate labelling is important, which allows consumers to exercise freedom of choice. So there are all sorts of issues here, and obviously those are just two examples around pesticides and GMOs, but that they would be at risk if some of this legislation was removed.
Thanks. I was wondering, Lloyd Austin, if you want to come in. I'm already getting lots of issues about water quality not being enforced, but we take for granted water quality and air quality. Are there issues there that this legislation puts at risk?
Yeah, I had mentioned a few issues. I mean, I agree everything with what Isabel mentioned about the habitats regulations and what David said about pesticides and so on, but other well-known EU retained law that affect the environment would include the implementation of the Water Framework Directive, which you mentioned, which is about water quality and water resource management. Obviously, bathing water's quality is related to it. What were previously EU standards. The Marine Strategy Framework Directive is another one that's implemented through regulations in Scotland and in the EU and in the UK. The whole system of environmental impact assessments and strategic impact assessments are obviously originated as and are now retained EU law. though, all of those examples are implemented by a mixture of primary legislation and secondary legislation, and whilst the primary legislation might not be affected, all of the secondary legislation, particularly that that derives that was implemented under the 72 European Communities Act, would be affected. But there is an element of retained EU law that is also described in the EU Withdrawal Act 2018 as saved EU rights, powers, liabilities, obligations, restrictions, remedies and procedures. And that's a catch-all provision that relates to EU law that had direct effect in the UK on withdrawal day. And that captures the provisions of the EU treaties that have been recognised as having direct effect in case law, if you see what I mean. And from our point of view, one of the key aspects of that is the EU environmental principles. Now, in the UK and in Scotland, those EU environmental principles have been put into domestic legislation, the Environment Act in the UK and the Continuity Act in Scotland, and yet those provisions have not yet been brought into force. They're not, neither the UK government or the Scottish government have finalised the policy statements about their implementation. They've neither published the final version nor have that version been approved by respective parliaments. And so we don't know how those principles are going to apply now. And so, in effect, revoking the direct effect of the principles as part of retained EU law in the absence of a proper arrangement for implementing the principles is a cliff edge in itself. And, of course, the application of those principles to the way in which all of the other measures, the habitats, the water, the marine, etc., regulations work, that is another impact that we have, which is an indirect one. And the trouble is that some of those kind of saved EU rights provisions are not, you know, if both the UK and the Scottish governments were to cut and paste some of the regulations into new regulations, whilst we've said that's going to be an onerous task, it is possible to do. But you can't cut and paste those retained case law rights, if that makes sense, or the interpretation that is the interpretation that's available of retained EU law in bits of case law. So that's that will be a void that we can't avoid, if you see what I mean.
Thanks. And Professor Reid, do you want to come in this point? Because your evidence is really quite powerful about the sheer scale of the legislation just on environment alone.
Yeah, and what I was going to do was pick up some of the complexities from the examples that have already been given, because in relation to water, the controlled activities regulations, which provide the detailed framework, they were made under the Water Environment and Water Services Scotland Act and under the European Communities Act. So presumably any bits of those regulations which were made only under the authority of the European Communities Act will disappear. Those that were made under the WOOS Act will survive. So somebody at some stage is going to have to go through the entire set of regulations and work out, well, was this provision authorised by both, by one only, what happens and what happens as a consequence of that? We've talked about environmental impact assessment. Environmental impact assessment at the project level is in delegated legislation, so it would be affected by the sunset. Strategic environmental assessment, because the Scottish Parliament decided to legislate separately on that, it will survive because it's in primary legislation in Scotland, but not in the rest of the UK. Environmental information is another area that will go, but that is a requirement under the Aarhus Convention that the UK is a party to. It's a requirement under the Trade and Cooperation Agreement between the UK and the EU. So you've got that extra layer of the international side to think about, as well as the internal and devolved. So I'm afraid if some of us seem a bit vague about the implications of this, it's because of the sheer scale of trying to work out and to work out these different layers.
Something in terms of what is the intended process by which law would be actually retained? We've talked about the scale of it, but just to say, what does it actually mean in terms of this legislation? To save a piece of legislation, what is the process for that? as currently construed by this bill?
It would appear that it's available for the relevant authority, whether the UK government or Scottish ministers could make regulations that would say this is going to, you know, these measures are going to survive. So presumably it would be possible for the Scottish ministers to have a one-page order with a 50-page schedule that listed absolutely everything. But the problem is that because of the things that would be going at the reserve level, things that would be going in the rest of the UK, that would produce a complete, you know, as trying to keep everything that the Scottish government has the power to keep would create as big a mess almost as the getting rid of everything, because the things are so interconnected and don't work together.
And because we've been told the dashboard isn't up to date. I mean, in terms of a legal perspective, what's your comment on that?
I totally believe everybody who says the dashboard is not up to date and whatever. And this issue about measures made under jointly under the European Communities Act and domestic legislation, I haven't had, you know, I've had a couple of discussions with people and they're in the same position as me thinking there might be a problem here, but nobody's got a clear answer.
Thank you. Was the only comment is on the ground, if you're actually implementing all of this, what's the reality check for this?
Well, yeah, I mean, in terms of the environment, I suppose in terms of the sort of environmental sphere, we have less involvement than all the other colleagues here today in terms of most of what we do is about physical safety and about fairness and so on. But there are some elements of environmental law that we do enforce locally, which I think make an additional point here, which I was going to make today, so I might as well make it now. And, you know, there's some specifics in there. I mean, there's one I put in the submission about volatile compounds in paints, you know, a very obscure set of regulations, which, but nevertheless, have an important environmental protection in there, you know. Now, that's not something, unlike the other stuff I've been talking about, that's not the sort of thing my colleagues deal with from day to day. But when, you know, evidence comes to light that somebody's in breach of these and is therefore harming the environment and getting an unfair competitive advantage over their competitors, the provisions are there and our guys will do something about that and deal with that. And my point about this is, you know, we're talking about, you know, the water directive and big stuff like that. Of course, that's what we should be focusing on. But all these other bits and pieces of law and these slightly obscure, specific, detailed pieces of law, my fear is that they just get ignored and they get lost almost by accident when the sunset clause comes in. I don't know what the answer is, but, you know, my appeal is for the UK government, Scottish government, whoever is involved in this, to do everything they can to not forget about the full list here.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much.
Mr. Golden.
Thanks, convener. Perhaps start with Professor Reid. In your submission, you highlight that the UK government's previously expressed a desire to drive improved environmental outcomes and has taken powers to achieve this through the Environment Act 2021, which were expressly intended to build upon retained environmental law. In the context of the retained EU law bill, I wonder what changes you could suggest, or whether there are other legal mechanisms that could be employed to attain that desired impact.
I think that, as people have said, the issue is that to try to reform, improve a complex area of law, there needs to be a sort of proper review of it. And it's interesting that in relation to financial services, the Treasury has managed to get that in a separate bill, and it's not going to be affected by the measures here. The financial services area is going to be reviewed thoroughly at its own timescale with a complete measures. So the difficulty is that by producing this very blunt instrument to create the cliff edge, at the same time as there's other bits of legislation pointing off in different directions. The Levelling Up Bill at Westminster has proposals for environmental impact assessment and how that's meant to fit together, you know, how the timescale of that, by the time the environmental impact assessment rules were changed under that measure, the sunset might have cut in, so it's not quite clear what's going. So I think the problem for outside observers is that it's just not clear what the UK government is thinking. You have some elements that point towards the policy clearly of greater environmental protection, some things that are being done to pursue that, but at the same time you've got things like this that seem to cut across it without a clear guidance, with a clear sense of how the dramatic powers to save or preserve laws are going to be exercised, and very little time for stakeholders, the devolved administrations and so on to make sense of what's going on.
Thank you. Would any of the rest of the panel like to comment? Yes, Isabel.
Yeah, thanks. I just wanted to come in on this question of kind of improving environmental law. I think understandably a lot of attention on this bill has been on the sunsetting provisions, but I just wanted to highlight some of the other problematic clauses in the bill from an environmental perspective. So clause 15 states that when replacing retained EU law ministers, so that would be UK or devolved ministers, must not increase the regulatory burden, and that is then defined as a financial cost, administrative inconvenience and an obstacle to trade, innovation, efficiency, productivity or profitability. So our reading of this is that it means if, for example, Scottish ministers wanted to use the powers in the bill to actually improve and strengthen environmental regulations, they may actually be unable to do that. They would potentially only be able to restate or amend regulations so that they remain at the same standard or lower. And that's why we feel that the kind of overall direction of the bill is kind of deregulatory in nature. So I just wanted to raise that particular point about clause 15.
Yeah, I mean, I would suggest that burden and standard perhaps can't be completely equated, but David.
Yeah, thank you. So so just to look at the impact on animal welfare, as I mentioned, there are 44 different pieces of animal welfare law. 18 of those are on farm animals. And just to give some examples of what could fall away, I mentioned the barren battery hen ban, but we also have the sow stall ban. We have the ban on veal crates. With the use of animals in research laboratories, all of that is under EU law. What people tend to forget is probably about 80% of animal welfare legislation is inherited from the EU. The first law was passed in 1974, a year after we joined, and in the subsequent 47 years of our membership, another 43 pieces of legislation were passed. So there's a real concern there in terms of if this is allowed to slip away. Another example. Yes, companion animals don't have that many EU-derived laws, but how we take our pets abroad on holiday is an EU-derived law. And if that slips away, then can people take their dogs away on holiday? Or the importation of puppies coming in from Europe, which is obviously something that the Scottish Government is looking at the moment, does that legislation immediately fall? So there are lots of challenges with this. One of the interesting things is that this bill had its genesis under the Johnson government. When the bill was originally written under the Johnson government, there was a deadline of 2028 in that. That was taken out under the Truss government and put in on 2023. So there is no reason why the government can't say, let's go back to the original deadline. 2028 seems to us to be much more sensible. And as others have said, it provides the continuity to look at all of this legislation in detail. There are parts that can be improved. Let's look at those, see what can be improved, and have a sensible, long-range discussion about how to do this rather than rush it. Thank you.
Thanks, that's very helpful.
Mr. Austin, what's coming?
Thank you. I just wanted to build on Professor Reid's comment, but in response to Mr. Golden's question about the Environment Act, because it does seem to me that across the UK government's various acts and proposed bills, there appears to be a bit of an incoherence in as much as there is good measures in the Environment Act, but that appears to be contradicted or made incoherent by proposals in other legislation, and that the other proposed legislation, either passed or going through Westminster, appears to have linkages between them that are not clear. So the other ones I would mention would be the UK Internal Market Act and the challenges in relation to what extent do different environmental regulations in different places either affect or not affect the market principles in that act. But I would particularly highlight the point that Professor Reid made about the Levelling Up Bill and the proposal in there for environmental outcome reports, they're called, I think, which enables ministers, UK ministers in that case, to effectively amend the environmental assessment regulations and create a new form of environmental assessment. Now, that process may or may not be positive for the environment and be consistent with the Environment Act ambitions, but it appears that the proposals in the Levelling Up Bill could be completely undermined if those environmental assessment regulations that one bill is seeking to improve are removed by the impact of the sunset clause in the retained EU bill. So we have two bills at Westminster, and I did give evidence to the Scottish Parliament on the legislative consent memorandum on the Levelling Up Bill. We have two bills at Westminster that appear to be incoherent or contradict each other, if you see what I mean. And both and taken together, they appear to contradict the ambitions of the Environment Act. So the interrelatedness between all the proposals seems to create an added level of complexity that makes it even more unmanageable.
Professor Reid, just on that specific point about contradictory legislation, from a legal perspective, which part would have supremacy and who would decide?
Well, the way of resolving it is to either extend the environmental assessment regulations until, you know, to the full deadline, which would give time for the other bill measures to take place, or to continue them on the basis that that was only going to be a temporary continuation and going through. But that requires that to have been thought about and to be done quickly. And given everything that's happening and everything that has to be done, I think at this stage there's no certainty that that sensible legal route would be identified and done in time.
Thank you.
I think Mr. Mackay wanted to come in as well.
Yes, thank you. To pick up very quickly on a point that Mr. Bowles had made about the sunset clause, and whilst we absolutely agree that a 2028 cut-off would be preferable to a 2023 or even a 2026, I think it risks overlooking a fundamental point that this clause shouldn't be there. We've yet to hear any convincing argument for why there should be an arbitrary deadline, a cliff edge, if you like, at all. Thank you.
Mm. Thank you. Mr. Ruskell.
I wanted to pick up a point that Professor Reid raised at the beginning, and I think it would be good to get other reflections as well, about EU case law and the status of that case law, which has been building up over many, many decades. I think there is a sort of phrase in the bill that says that EU case law shouldn't restrict the proper development of domestic law. And I think as a committee we've been struggling to understand what proper development actually constitutes. So I wondered if Professor Reid could offer some thoughts on that, and then if there are others who've got concerns or questions about how they think this may play out in terms of habitats regulations or other EU case law, that would be useful. So, Professor Reid.
I think my answer to that is that you're not alone in struggling to work out what is meant by the proper development of domestic law. There are a few areas where, not so much in the environment, where that has been a build-up. There was a body of domestic law which the EU was working on, slightly different approach, slightly different ideas. So the interpretation, there was a conflict and you could see a restoration to the more domestic flow. But in many areas, and the environment is one of them, the domestic law and the EU law have been so intertwined for so long that it's very hard to see what that means. Does it have any particular meaning? See, there are some areas where, in areas of employment law and so on, where EU concepts didn't exactly match the traditional UK way of thinking about things, where it might have more sense, but I certainly don't know, and nobody I know I've spoken to has a clear idea of what the proper development of domestic law means.
Thanks.
Mr. Mercer, sorry. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, I'd firstly just like to say, A, that I'm relieved to hear from Professor Reid that there's a lot of confusion about this particular clause. And I think it just further highlights, as he said, the huge uncertainty and complexity around this and the kind of interplay between different pieces of regulation, legislation, case law. But just coming back to one particular example around the habitats regulations, there is a huge body of case law and European guidance that's been absolutely critical in the kind of effective interpretation and application of the Birds and Habitats Directive and subsequently the habitats regulations in the UK and Scotland, which has been absolutely fundamental for ensuring that some of our most important wildlife sites and species are properly protected from plans and projects that could potentially affect them. So, I think, again, it just highlights the huge uncertainty about what are the implications for some of these areas. At this stage, we just don't really fully understand what the implications would be.
Mm. OK. Do others want to come in on this? David?
Yeah, just from our perspective, the sort of consumer protection trading laws and that, like environment, very much intertwined with EU case law over many, many years now. And given the approach of the EU to design consumer protection laws in a sort of principles-based way rather than, you know, a list of specific provisions, clearly what goes with that is, you know, we like that because it allows reasonable and fair interpretation to fit a very wide range of circumstances, but we are dependent, to a significant degree in some areas, on case law to further define what those things mean in specific situations. The Germans do a lot of the heavy lifting on that in terms of the cases that come through. I am completely confused as to where we are with the future on that. I really am. It's going to make interpretation much more difficult for us. What I do know is that clearly there's going to be the potential for a sudden serious downgrading of the influence of that body of interpretation on what we do, and that causes problems. That really does. And that causes problems for businesses too, because they've got to have certainty as to what these things mean. When they're designing their next year's work plan and the year after, they need that. So this isn't just consumers that are affected by this, it's businesses too, you know. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else want to come in on that? I suppose I was partly interested with the interrelationship with the environmental principles as well, because I think, Lloyd Austin, you'd said that the environmental principles are not yet embedded. You know, they've been stated, but they're not yet embedded. So do the principles run through case law as well? If we took, say, the precautionary principle, is that embedded in case law but not embedded enough in legislation to ensure that that would remain...
Yeah, so as Isabel Mercer said, the implementation and the interpretation of a lot of EU law is very reliant on past EU cases. So Isabel mentioned the Birds and Habitats Directive, but the same applies to the Water Framework Directive and Bathing Waters Directive and Environmental Assessment Directives as well. Which have seen many cases go to the European Court, and therefore those cases that are determined at the European Court then influence the way in which the public authorities in all the member states implement their various domestic interpretations of those directives. I think the key thing is that when the European Court has been determining those cases, they do so, as was mentioned earlier, on a principles-based way, and therefore the principles that are in the treaty often inform the way in which the Court reaches its decision, and it's sort of set out in the way in which the case is reported, etc. And that is what I've described as the third area of retained EU law that the Withdrawal Act specifies. So the Withdrawal Act specifies three categories of retained EU law: EU-derived domestic legislation, direct EU legislation, and saved EU rights. And the case law forms part of the saved EU rights. And those are the aspects that would be very difficult to cut and paste into new regulations. And I think that therefore means that even if you save all of the regulations, either in the way that Colin Reid described earlier or by doing, you know, hundreds of new regulations, which you would need to do at both UK and Scottish level because of the interconnectedness, that those kind of interpretations that are available through case law, they disappear. You can't cut and paste those into new legislation. And so, you know, in terms of the environmental principles, I think that gives this bill, this retained EU law bill, gives another question over what should be in the policy statement from the Scottish Government and the equivalent one from the UK Government as to whether or not aspects of the implementation of those principles in the past should be included in that policy statement, which might be one reason why the policy statements haven't appeared. So that's a question which I don't know the answer to, but I think it does underline the importance of those saved EU rights and case law, as you say.
Thanks.
Professor?
So, of course, on the principles, under the Continuity Act, the principles only apply to public authorities in making policy. They don't apply to the courts. So this reservation in the Continuity Act doesn't actually help the courts, I think. Some of you will have studied it, some of you will have seen it in more stages going through, but I fail to think it's just the effect of public authorities in making policy.
I don't think any of us have.
We can check
the complexity and the difficulties that.
Okay, but the main point here is that they're no longer part of the acquis that we, you know, haven't adopted. So they might be in a Treaty of Lisbon or whatever, but we're no longer part of that, and we're not in that context anymore. So where they get put is important. Okay, that was me.
Thank you. I'll move to Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to ask about regulatory divergence, which I think we all appreciate that this bill has to be read in conjunction with the Scottish Government's stated policy of aligning with EU law. Last week, we heard from some witnesses, principally those in the farming, agricultural and fisheries space, that there were potentially opportunities presented in the ability to diverge. I hear very clearly what people have said about wanting to align with environmental law in the EU, but are there any areas that people here believe it would be beneficial for Scotland just to do its own thing? And I say that in terms of, I heard people talk about, you know, not being resistant to change. I just wondered if there were any areas that people thought Scotland could go its own way.
Mr. Bowles?
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. I mean, and Lloyd mentioned this earlier on, that there is real complexity here between how the rule bill works with not just the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, but also the Common Frameworks Agreement and the Internal Markets Act. And to be honest, nobody understands how all of those interplay. The Common Frameworks Agreement has a specific agreement on animal welfare, but it is done essentially by consensus. And if I'm being brutally honest, it's never really been tested when different governments have different opinions on it. The Internal Markets Act is essentially a UK government's act which tells the Scottish Government what they need to do with the free movement of produce within Great Britain. And that is a problem as well. I mentioned earlier on about beef hormones. So, for instance, where the UK government has reserve powers, like on trade, if they do trade agreements with Canada, Mexico, both of whom have cattle which are injected with hormones, which is illegal in the EU, obviously, and is illegal in the UK under EU legislation that's been transposed. But if the UK government does a trade agreement with those, allowing that in, and under the REAL bill, the beef hormone legislation drops, That is a big problem, not just for animal welfare, but also from the free movement of beef within Great Britain and also for the exports of beef to the EU, because the first thing the EU would be doing is how can you audit this trail and how can you ensure us that no beef is coming into the EU, which is illegal, i.e. it's being treated with hormones, and you can't do that. So I think there are huge complexities here, which the UK government has not yet grappled with, which is essentially around what is the interplay with the common frameworks, with the Internal Markets Act and the REAL Bill. And yes, obviously there are areas, as other witnesses have said, where we want Scotland to go further. We want Scotland to improve their agriculture under the Agriculture Bill, and there are huge opportunities to do that. But I think you have to be mindful of how this interplays with the TCA and also how it interplays with those other pieces of legislation.
I'm grateful for that, because actually one of the criticisms that is made of the UK Internal Market Act is that it doesn't allow regulatory divergence. And I suppose what I'm interested to explore is, are there areas where divergence from EU law or divergence from UK law could be beneficial for Scotland's interests? Mr. Austin.
Yeah, OK. First of all, on the UK Internal Market Act, we would make that criticism that it does prevent regulatory divergence if that were a good idea. And the one example that did happen was the Scottish Government's proposal in relation to single-use plastics. They actually had to kind of apply to the UK Government for an exemption under the UK Internal Markets Act, which was granted, which was good. I think that the UK Internal Market Act would be improved if that sort of process wasn't necessary. I think in relation to your comment about keeping pace, I mean, we very much welcome the Scottish Government's approach to seeking to align with or to maintain or exceed EU environmental standards. I think that's a good ambition, but it's an ambition that needs to be delivered, because there are examples of not taking place. And you mentioned fisheries stakeholders, and I can see why they welcome this not keeping pace that is being currently proposed in relation to discards. So currently the EU law on discards applies, and it appears the Scottish Government want to not keep pace with that provision and to allow greater discards, and so therefore that's an example of where the Scottish Government isn't keeping pace where we think it should. I think in terms of divergence and being different, I mean, one aspect that is possible is, of course, EU law in the environment field was always a floor. It was never a ceiling. Member states were always able to be better. And the Scottish Government, well, executive at the time, chose to do that with strategic environmental assessment, for instance. So the Environmental Assessment Act, Scotland Act, was in many ways, it was primary legislation rather than under the European Communities Act regulations, because the Scottish Government at the time, with the support of others in the Parliament, chose to go further, so that the SEAs are now required on government strategies, as well as on the narrow definition of plans that was in the directive. So that's one area where you can diverge by being better. Mm-hmm. Another area where I think you could diverge by being better is in the field of agriculture. So, for instance, in organic agriculture or in supporting environmentally friendly farmers and crofters, Alistair, the Scottish Government could do a lot better than the CAP used to do. And the consultation on the agriculture bill that's ongoing is enabling that conversation to happen. So, for instance, I think that is an area where, supporting what I would call nature-friendly farmers and crofters to remain being nature-friendly or to contribute to the restoration of nature is somewhere where the Scottish Government could be different to the EU or different to the rest of the UK to the benefit of Scotland's environment.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to come in on that? David, yes.
Just one small example, labelling. So there is one piece of retained EU law on labelling, which is obviously on eggs, has been in place since 2004, has had an enormous impact on improving egg production in Scotland and also giving consumers the information they need to make the choices when they go into their supermarket. Now, there is an opportunity for Scotland to expand that into labelling on other products, pigs, chickens, other farm products. The EU is not yet moving on labelling. The UK government has said that they are minded to do it. It is a reserved issue, and it's a perfect opportunity for Scotland to showcase their food and give the consumers the information they need and help their farmers. Thank you.
Yes, David.
just to add to that, I think we, generally speaking, would agree that we see the opportunities for improving existing legislation rather than going in the other direction. One point I would make, I think Mr. Bowles talked about the trade and cooperation agreement. Within that, come the end of next year, there needs to be a review and an agreement on equivalence. So going back to points I made earlier around regulations on organic production, at the moment, the UK is operating on the previous EU regulation, and there is now a new regulation within the EU, which has been adopted in Ireland, in Northern Ireland, should I say, as a result of the Northern Ireland Protocol, but not in the rest of the UK yet. Now, there are various things that are happening at the moment, not least the gene editing, the precision breeding bill going through Parliament, where we are concerned that it will potentially be quite difficult to come to an agreement on equivalence with the EU at that point if the UK has diverged. So I think we just need to be mindful of how this interacts with some of these other agreements that are in place.
So thank you for that. I've got one quite specific question for Professor Reid, which I was very taken with your description in your evidence about the fact that in Scotland, and I think you've touched on this morning too, that there is some primary legislation which is not caught by the bill, whereas in England, because it's made under regulation, it is. And you give the example of the environmental assessments, strategic environmental assessment, and the Water Framework Directive. I just wondered if there were any other examples you could think of where that sort of strange tension exists?
I'm sure there are. I haven't done the database, the full survey to see what there is. The position was that on, before the Scottish Parliament existed, on many aspects, Scottish-only legislation hadn't been updated as quickly, as frequently as that for England and Wales. So when we had to make changes to comply with EU law, often it made sense to do wider changes, so things that could be done as small changes in England and Wales required more change, and the opportunity was taken by the Scottish Parliament to make proper, wider considerations, such as on the water framework materials. But I suspect, this is one of the problems, one of the tasks that has to be done, is to try to identify exactly where these differences are. And a further complication in all of this is, of course, that because we've had the European Communities Act, it's been the go-to. People have just used that because you knew there was power to do stuff under that. Actually, in many cases, there probably was existing domestic legislation that did most of it that could give the authority. But because you had the European Communities Act, why bother searching and, if necessary, tweaking the primary legislation to give the power to do exactly what you wanted? And whether there are records, accounts of exactly the thinking behind the legislative process 30, 40 years ago, I don't know.
Just one other thing. Even Maurice Golden touched on this kind of difference between burden and standards. Yep. And I just wondered, from a legal perspective, do you have any observation on that?
Only that the test in the bill is very, very vague. What one person's... is it Minister of Inconvenience is the phrase? I can't remember exactly what it is that's included and exactly what that means, and administrative inconvenience to whom, because any process that the government has to operate, you could say, is an administrative inconvenience for businesses equally. Any form, anything reporting has to be, it is going to be a burden of some sort.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Sorry, I should have referred to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you, Convener. my question, I suppose, for mainly for those of you working in devolved areas, but others feel free to join in. A couple of you have touched on how this bill would impact on the wider nature of devolution and how that in turn would impact on you. There's been a couple of references made, I think by Colin Reid and David Bowles, on how it might impact how it might relate to other pieces of legislation, thinking of the UK Internal Market Act and also the declining meaning of the Sewell Convention, which is something this committee has looked at. So just keen to open up a discussion about the wider impact on the devolution settlement, if such a thing now exists.
I can kick off. I mean, the honest answer is it could have huge ramifications on devolution, and particularly on what Scotland is allowed or permitted to do. The UK government, frankly, does not have a clear idea on which pieces of the real bill are devolved and which are not. And that's why, and I've said the same message to the Welsh government, who obviously are like the Scottish government and are minded to do an LCM which recommends rejection of the bill. And I've said to them that the best way is for each of the devolved governments to do their own impact assessment and work out what is devolved at the minute, and if in doubt, say it's devolved and see how the UK government reacts. I think that is the best way of doing it. And to go back to the professor's suggestion, which you may well be in that position coming forward, to have a very simple bill with a huge long schedule, just stick as many of the 2,500 pieces of legislation under it and see how the UK government reacts. Because frankly, if you leave it up to the UK government, you've got a deadline which happens in 13 months' time, and secondly, then you are handing over your power to the UK government to make your decisions for you, and I don't think that's a good position to be in.
Anyone else want to come in?
Welcome.
I think in relation to devolution, I think we, throughout the conversation this morning, we've talked about there being some things that are reserved and some things that are devolved, and so there are responsibilities to do the review and revisions and retain what they wish on both UK ministers and Scottish ministers. Now, UK ministers do have the option under Section 2 of the bill to extend the sunset so that the really awful cliff edge of the end of next year is a slightly better cliff edge of June 2026. But in relation to devolved things, that option isn't available to Scottish ministers. So that seems to be an odd anomaly. We're of the view, as with others, that the uncertainty and unmanageability and risks and everything else associated with the bill are so great that you can't really make it better, and we would support it being withdrawn or parked, and a sensible, proactive way of reviewing law taking place. But one thing that would make it less bad in relation to devolution, without reaching the place where it's acceptable, to make it less bad, would be to extend the Clause 2 power about extension of the sunset to Scottish ministers and Welsh ministers, of course, and Northern Ireland ministers, so that in relation to devolved matters, they could apply an extension in order to allow them greater time. I would also suggest that, you know, if you're going to make it less bad, that the deadline should be far longer than 26. I mean, David Bell's mentioned 28, but I mean, you could pick a 2030 or 2035 or 2045 or any date you like. The longer the better, to give you the proper amount of time to do a sensible review and involve consultation and do the detailed analysis of all the interrelatedness and complexities that Professor Reid has described.
Thank you. Yeah, I would agree with everything that Mr. Austin just said, although I have to say I also do agree with Mr. Mackay's comments earlier that there shouldn't be the cliff edge provision in the bill at all, but agree that if we're going to be looking at making this bill less bad, then yes, at a minimum, extending the powers to extend the sunset provision to devolved ministers as well would be absolutely critical to make sure there aren't those kind of immediate significant capacity and resourcing implications here in Scotland. I also just wanted to highlight the fact that the UK government's own independent Better Regulation Watchdog, the Regulatory Policy Committee, found that the impact assessment of the bill was not fit for purpose and red-rated it due to the inadequate analysis of the impacts of the bill on, I think, business innovation, trade, but also implications for the devolved administration. So I think that's quite telling about the level of uncertainty and risk that we're talking about here. And I would just underscore again the comments that have already been made around the fact that the dashboard is incomplete and it doesn't highlight which pieces of regulation are devolved and which pieces of regulation are reserved. And that is going to be a huge undertaking. As Mr. Austin highlighted earlier, DEFRA has now potentially identified over 1,000 pieces of legislation that fall within their portfolio. We have no idea how many regulations, environmental regulations in Scotland, are going to be affected by this. And then, yeah, just sometimes identifying which regulations are reserved and devolved is really complicated. So I just wanted to highlight one other example I don't think that's been mentioned so far yet, which is around invasive alien species. So as the committee may be aware, invasive non-native species is one of the top five drivers of biodiversity loss globally. It's a major issue. And actually, it's something where preventing the spread is absolutely critical, because later on, the cost of tackling inns once they're established is absolutely enormous. But my understanding, and Professor Reid maybe could shed some more light, is that the regulations for inns is a mixture of reserved and devolved. And again, it's just going to be really difficult to make sure that we've identified and captured all the regulations and ensure that there aren't any gaps left over in that critical area.
No. yes, Mr. McKenzie.
Yeah, I mean, we're resolutely apolitical, so I won't stray into the debate, but devolved, you know, devolution. But in a technical sense, you know, as I said, we fear the negative effect the sunset clause could potentially have. And I would concur with a lot of the comments that have just been made by colleagues. And one thing I would add to it is the point about, as I understand it, the sunset clause, the potential extension of the sunset clause is on a case-by-case basis rather than on any kind of blanket or topic basis. And that, to me, creates a real danger, like in some of the points I said earlier, that some of the maybe less well-known stuff is even more likely to get overlooked, perhaps. And some of that stuff is just as important as the stuff that's better known, and so on and so forth. So I don't know what the answer is to that, but that strikes me as a real concern.
Mr. Mackay.
Yes, thank you, conveners. Wanted to make one more point in response to Dr. Allen's question, and I think this has been flagged earlier in the session, but around UK common frameworks. So we submitted evidence fairly recently on UK common frameworks, and in particular the framework around organic production. We had a number of questions and issues with the way in which that had been set up, but you know, speaking generally, we thought that it was at least an agreed structure and process. So we have, for example, a Four Nations Working Group, which is the decision-making body involving UK government and the devolved administrations to consider any policy or regulatory divergence when it comes to organic and what the implications of that might be. And there's also an expert group on organic production, which acts in an advisory role. And then there's a dispute mechanism, and the framework acknowledges that there will be disputes. In fact, I think it acknowledged that there wasn't yet agreement on what was reserved and what was devolved. But you know, putting those shortcomings aside, at least there is an agreed system for trying to deal with some of these issues and respecting the role and responsibilities of the devolved administrations. And again, we don't see that within this bill, and that may be a starting point, perhaps, to look at some of these issues.
Thank you.
Are you finished, Dr. Allen?
Yeah.
Bring in Ms. Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and this has been a really informative discussion. Thank you very much, and thank you again for all the written evidence. I'd like to turn to the practical impacts of the bill. I think it was really interesting. David McKenzie, and I hope I don't misquote you, talked about EU legislation being a principled creation of that. And David Mackay and David Bowles have both talked about your own experiences of being involved in the creation of EU legislation. So I'm interested from a practical perspective how you see this bill changing that ability to feed in to legislation and therefore impacting as well on the scrutiny that the Scottish Parliament can do, because we've talked a lot about the executives making decisions, but how we as the Scottish Parliament and you as organisations are going to be able to feed in practically to this legislation. David, I don't know if you want to start.
Yes, thank you. I can start on that. And I guess the first point to make is absolutely we see it as essential for relevant stakeholder organisations to be able to contribute and to hold the government to account and to analyse these issues. I think to go back to the example of the common frameworks, this was one of the points we made in our evidence where there actually wasn't an adequate provision for that level of stakeholder engagement. Under the previous system at EU level, there was something called a civil dialogue group, which allowed organisations to have a say, and we made the case that there should be representation from the industry, from the organic sector, within the Four Nations Working Group itself, which was effectively comprised of civil servants, as far as we could see. So we would be very concerned if there was in any way through this process that some of that stakeholder engagement was lost.
Wells, you, I think you said that there was about over 40 acts had been brought in from environmental over 47 years. Animal welfare, my apologies, yeah. Over 47 years. So clearly to undo that in such a short period of time, as you've said, we could lose a lot of what we've gained.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to echo what David Mackay has just said, I mean, some of these pieces of legislation, like the battery hens ban, lasted 3 years from publication until final agreement in the European Parliament and by the Council of Ministers, and rightly so, because that allowed for expert opinion, allowed for consultation, and it allowed for improvement to the piece of legislation. Mm-hmm. What we have now is the possible scrapping of all that within literally months. Mm-hmm. And I think it's instructive that, I mean, yes, the Scottish Government were invited and gave evidence to the Bill Committee in Westminster, but the Welsh Government didn't and weren't. And I'm not even clear as to how much the real bill has been discussed at the Common Frameworks portfolio. And I don't believe it has really been necessarily discussed that much. And if you're going to do good legislation, and let's be clear, the Scottish Parliament, as the UK Parliament and the Welsh Senedd, they are in it to do good legislation, which achieves an objective and lasts for a long time. And if you're doing that, the only way to do it is by getting the evidence, as you're doing today, looking at the facts, and then, yes, sometimes making balances and making difficult decisions, but you're basing it on evidence. And this bill does the exact opposite. Because it applies the principle of everything goes under the sunset clause, it is doing the exact opposite of looking at that evidence and applying those factual principles.
Thank you. Isabel, do you want to?
Thank you. Yeah, I would absolutely agree with everything that Mr. Bowles just said. And just to add a quick comment to that, I suppose we've talked quite a lot about the kind of capacity and resource constraints that would be put upon the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament in delivering this. But those resource and capacity constraints also apply to other stakeholders who want to engage in this process and ensure that any laws that are replacing or being amended are strong and implementable and aren't going to have unintended adverse consequences. And so for organisations like the RSPB, Scottish Environment Link, and many other environmental NGOs, for example, our core focus at the moment is ensuring that Scotland has an appropriate and ambitious response to the nature and climate emergency. And that will involve improving a lot of our existing laws and protections, like ensuring that the Natural Environment Bill that's going to be brought forward in a year's time is really ambitious and can really make sure that we deliver ecosystem restoration at scale across Scotland. But all of that is going to become really difficult if our organisations are going to be distracted by ensuring that existing effective protections don't fall off the statute book.
Mr. Austin.
Thank you. I was going to. I agree with everything David Bowles and Isabel Merce said, but building on that, I think one of the things that gives us concern of this bill is partly due to the lack of time, but partly due to the kind of indiscriminate nature of it, that this leads to an undue kind of resource pressure on governments, both the UK government, Scottish government, Welsh and Northern Irish governments, to review and make a decision about how to go forward. But even if they managed to achieve that, would that be done with any engagement? Would they have time to do that with any engagement with relevant stakeholders? Obviously, the environmental NGOs would be wanting to be involved in the environmental issues, but we would equally agree that other stakeholders should be involved, whether those be farmers, grafters, fishermen, businesses, etc., etc. Trying to do such an engagement process in such a limited amount of time, it will almost be impossible. But then, if they wish to retain or in exact forms or amend and have a revised version, the relevant government will have to lay statutory instruments under this bill to do those retentions or amendments. And that, if there are hundreds or thousands of them, which seems likely, will be a new pressure on the Parliament, which will be distracting from things that you and the Scottish Government want to do in any case. And so I think, as a consequence of the lack of time and the indiscriminate nature of it, the resource pressures on the government, on the Parliament and on the stakeholders will be immense. And ensuring that it's reaches a sensible conclusion is, going to be a real challenge. And I think, the risk of trying to do something simple and something being missed is immense. And that's the main reason why we would want to see the bill dropped and the review done the other way round, so that as a government wishes to on individual areas, they have a sensible process to do the review and bring forward a proposal to change. I mean, retained EU law, although it's got the word EU in it, it's now UK and or devolved law. And we can change it as we want, but we're changing it should be done through the normal process of engagement and consultation and, as David said, evidence.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, I'm struggling to think through how all this law can be retained in a fast-tracked way. I mean, is there a competent way to fast-track the retention of this law? I think David Bowles, you were saying earlier on, you could sort of put it all in an appendix to the law. You just have thousands and thousands of laws. I mean, and is there a danger that if something was fast-tracked in that way, then that might be seen as inadequate and could be legally challenged as well, because there hadn't been proper impact assessments done on every single one of the thousands of laws that had... I'm just trying to understand what the complexities might be, and if there genuinely is a simple way, should ministers wish to retain that law. But
I mean, there's always a danger with fast-tracking that it hasn't been properly thought through and there aren't the proper checks, scrutiny and so on. One would assume that preserving the status quo, by keeping the current retained law going, that's the least likely to get you into trouble. But the problem is that keeping the bits of retained law that the Scottish Parliament has the power to do, Scottish Government have the power to do, A, you may not get you may not identify everything correctly. And secondly, that keeping those bits, they won't necessarily work because of the connections with all sorts of other bits, reserved matters, other bits of domestic law. And so I must admit, I quite like the idea of the Scottish Parliament passing a simple bill, trying to keep everything, and then throw the challenge to the UK government and Parliament to say, right, tell us what we can't do. But that would obviously end up in the courts and quite a long way through, but it might be a more interesting way of dealing with things. But interest isn't necessarily a good thing in real life, I know.
So the UK government, and I think we got consensus from our last panel last week, was that if, you know, reversing it to be the default position is to keep and then review is required, would be a much more sensible position.
That was the position taken at the time of the Withdrawal Act, that everything was rolled over in the absolute expectation that in the years to come, as and when necessary, areas of law would be reviewed to place the where divergence was a good thing, we would do that. That's what's happening in relation to financial services. It's been set aside as an area that's subject to its own comprehensive review.
Mr. Bowles?
Yeah, isn't it ironic that that under the Withdrawal Act we took just over 2.5 years to pull all those pieces of legislation across? Essentially what we were doing was just changing the word Commission and writing in UK Government or Scottish Parliament or whatever. But even then mistakes were made. And some pieces of legislation went back 2 or 3 times before they got it right. And that was in 2.5 years. And the UK Government is asking you to do this within 13 months.
Can I maybe ask what the dangers are for enforcement then? For I suppose, David, you might have been the person who's looking to interpret and enforce more than others around the table today. I mean, what are the dangers? You know, can you give us an example of a practical problem?
Yeah, sure. I mean, as one of your other contributors made at a previous session, the problem is it's been replaced. If something's getting replaced, if it falls victim to the Sunset Clause, it's been replaced by nothing, you know? Mm-hmm. And that means that even the stuff that could be, we think could be improved, is being replaced by nothing, which is worse than what we've got at the moment. And, you know, while some of the law that we enforce, we don't have to enforce, you know, particularly actively, because there's a general consensus amongst most of that industry that they can, as soon as you take those regulations away, businesses are quite rightly going to think, well, maybe I can get a competitive advantage here by slightly changing what I do to, and it might be, I mentioned things like weights and measures and product safety, you know, some of these really tight safety standards that have been produced over, you know, over decades of scientific experience and practical experience, may seem a little onerous in some ways. Let's not do that one. But that needs proper consideration. If we're going to review a standard or review a regulation, as everyone said, it needs to be discussed properly. We need to look at all the pros and cons and take the opportunities to change it in a measured way over a period of time. So it's what we're involved in, it's fundamental to the daily lives of communities, as I keep saying, buying and selling goods and services. And as soon as you take those regulations away, certainly some of the less well-minded businesses, of which we have a few, not many, but a few in Scotland, will take advantage of that. But even good reputable businesses, quite rightly, they've got shareholders to think about, will review that, and we could be head into a situation where consumers and reputable businesses are less well protected in a very clear way, it seems to me.
Okay, Mr. Mackay.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to make the point that thinking of organic food productions, organic farming or crofting, there are, you know, one of the strengths of organic as a brand, and why consumers have that confidence and assurance in it, is that there's a very robust scheme of inspection, and there needs to be compliance with standards, and those standards are underpinned by law. And we mentioned earlier in the session what some of those laws are. If you didn't have that legal basis, then, you know, we have a standalone subsidiary, Soil Association Certification, which is one of 6 control bodies within the UK. There wouldn't be any legal basis in which to enforce that compliance with the standards. And yes, I mean, I think technically you could argue that you could have a kind of private system whereby the rules were adhered to on that basis. But again, you know, I'm an organic licensee, and there are many reasons why people decide to farm organically. One of them is that robustness, that the strength, and organic farming is often viewed as a gold standard. And if you remove that legislative underpinning, then I would fear that would be lost, and that impacts not just upon producers but on consumers as well.
Mr. Austin?
I think one of the difficulties here is the level of uncertainty and lack of clarity. And depending on what happens, obviously a number of environmental laws are enforced by a range of bodies, you know, whether that be the police, by local authorities, whether it be Scottish Environment Protection Agency or Nature Scot. There's a range of public bodies that are responsible for enforcement. And obviously, if a piece of law is clearly revoked or repealed, and they know that's the case, they're not going to try and enforce it. But if they don't know what the situation is as to whether or not it has been retained under this provision or not, what are they going to do? And even if it's the government's intention to retain something, and when I say government, I mean UK government or Scottish government, the level of uncertainty about what laws exist come January 24 or don't exist will be have a real chilling effect, I think, on those bodies. They won't really know whether the law exists or not. And I think that will actually be a situation where they become really nervous about whether they should undertake any enforcement action or not. And there'll be an awful lot of kind of administrative checks being having to be undertaken in order to work out whether or not there's some enforcement action they can take before taking it. And that will create a situation where the few businesses who may be trying to get away with something will feel more empowered to try and get away with it.
Ms. Boyack?
Thank you. Just to follow on that point, because one of the points made in the RSPB evidence, which I'd quite like to just explore, is the whole issue of uncertainty. And the fact that in different pieces of UK legislation, ministers have actually said they've given reassurances about devolution settlements, but it's just how we actually, it's a chilling effect that's just been talked about, how you actually have any certainty on that. And I was going to come to you, Isabel, because the issue of the levelling up legislation and the Environmental Act, there's been reassurances given, but if it's just words, where's the legal impact of that, given the uncertainty here and people not being prepared to push the envelope if they're worried about the legal status?
Yeah, I mean, I think it just comes back to all the points that have been made today about the level of uncertainty and risk involved in this sunsetting provision. And as you said, there's been various reassurances made, but I think until we saw a different approach being brought forward to this piece of legislation, we wouldn't be able to be reassured that these potential huge issues relating to gaps in environmental law are going to take place. So I think it's just that we need to have the reassurance of a change in approach to this bill so that that sunset provision and that date of either 2023 or 26 is changed.
And Professor Reid, I don't know if you want to come in on that. It's really unusual to have a piece of legislation in front of you with other bits of legislation being used as, well, don't worry about this legislation, these bits of legislation might help. And we don't actually have the detail of those bits of legislation either. Is that unprecedented or?
It's unusual to have government policies going off in so many different directions at the same time and being reflected in bills. The levelling up bill, the change there to environmental impact assessment compared to this. And in a sense, going back earlier, because a lot of many of the provisions in the Withdrawal Act are duplicating other measures that already exist in sectoral legislation and so on, but you've got this on top, and now we've got this on top of that, and this on top of that, and trying to keep track of the different levels and different dimensions, it's really hard. And because there isn't overlapping provisions aren't necessarily, powers aren't necessarily a problem, but they are a problem if they're being used by different people in different ways. And at present, there doesn't seem to be a clear single policy, still clear single direction that gives anybody confidence to say what's likely to be happening in the next 6-12 months.
Thanks. I mean, that's really helpful. That's very much what the Law Society of Scotland said when we had a discussion about this a couple of weeks ago. Thank you very much.
Mr. Cameron?
Yeah, just on some practicalities, the committee keeps hearing evidence about the scale of the task before agencies, businesses, sectors, etc. And can I just ask you what engagement the Scottish Government has had with you, and is there anything the Scottish Government could be doing in relation to helping with this endeavour? I don't know if anyone... Has anyone had any interaction with the Scottish Government about this? Yes, Isabel.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, probably just a brief point, just to say we've had some initial discussions with Scottish Government officials about the bill to kind of sense check our kind of initial assessment of the bill and some of the issues for Scotland. But again, I would just kind of reiterate a lot of the comments we've already made throughout this session that I think really we're looking for the UK government to revisit the overall approach to the bill, and that again the dashboard needs to be updated comprehensively so that we have clarity that we've identified the whole range of rule and that there's clarity over which rule is reserved and which is devolved, and I think until those kind of fundamental questions have been answered, it's quite difficult to determine exactly what action is needed here in Scotland.
Yes.
Yeah, from our point of view, we've had some very brief discussions with the Scottish Government, but not an awful lot. And I suppose that reflects, we are speaking to the Scottish Government about a wide range of things because we do so many different bits and pieces of work. I think broadly our position is that we would like to see the devolved stuff that affects what we do largely retained, and then let's have a conversation about it in light of what we've said today. So we're feeding a lot of our interaction with government to the UK government through colleagues in England and Wales on this, particularly with a focus on trying to retain the things that need to be retained, but also on a positive basis with the stuff that can be improved, because there's some real stuff there within the reserved body of law that affects us that we think can be improved in quite a clear way, you know. So that's, I suppose, where I mean, sorry, and just finally, this point that keeps coming up about interrelatedness, I really stress how important that is for the practicalities of what we do. So even if Scottish Government does everything we think it should do, or Parliament does everything it should do, it's going to be affected about what happens in England and at Westminster. So any communication that can be made between Scotland and England on the basis of that, we would welcome.
I appreciate that, and I suppose my question is, the bill gives the Scottish Government the ability to restate EU law, etc., as we all know, and I just... Lloyd, you want to come in?
Yes, I've had very little contact with the Scottish Government about this. Obviously, I'm aware of the legislative consent memorandum and so forth, but we have had some brief discussions with officials, which are obviously informal in nature at the moment, but I think the... I don't think they stated this, but the impression I received was a significant degree of concern about the scale of the task. I think not only the scale, but the uncertainty in terms of, you know, they were telling us of their concerns about the dashboard being incomplete, as well as we were telling us them our concerns about the dashboard being incomplete and the lack of clarity on their dashboard, but of the, which are reserved and which are devolved and so forth. But I would say there's a sort of a fundamental kind of concern here. So the Scottish Government has a number of very good environmental ambitions ambitions in relation to things that affect the environment in terms of the agriculture bill that's forthcoming, the natural environment bill that Isabel referred to earlier, the climate change plan, etc., etc. And I think that the biggest concern is that in order to do a review and even a restating of all of the legislation in 12 months, which it will be in a couple of weeks' time, would distract the number of officials who are doing all those good things and are trying to get forward those positive ambitions. And that, you know, often they will effectively need to put all that on hold in order to do a restatement. And that just seems to me to be not the right way to address a climate and nature emergency.
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to add a brief comment to what I said earlier, and I agree with what Mr. Austin said. Something we haven't actually mentioned is that specifically in relation to this bill, the Scottish Government has made a number of public comments, both in writing and in the Chamber, about the fact that they plan to maintain or exceed EU environmental standards. And so I just wanted to say that that is hugely welcome. And we are assuming that what that means is they plan to, as Mr. Austin was outlining, restate the majority of rule and move that over onto Scotland's statute because it's assimilated law. But I think just coming back to that point about uncertainty, that doesn't address all of our concerns because, as I was outlining with the example about the habitats regulations, unless both the UK and the Scottish habitats regulations were restated, then there potentially would still be quite a large gap that could cause harm to some of Scotland's most important species and habitats.
I know it will be of little comfort, but the RSPCA and Greener UK have had very little contact with the UK government on this bill, who are obviously leading on it. We haven't met with the bill team of the UK government, which is almost unprecedented on any piece of legislation we work with. As you know, during the committee stages, which finished this week, the government didn't take any amendments and indeed seemed to be oblivious and deaf to any concerns on the timetable, on the impact on business, on the impact of animal welfare and environmental legislation. So, yes, the RSPCA and the SSPCA stand by to help the Scottish Government with anything they need, particularly on what we believe is devolved and non-devolved and some options. But really, the ball lies in the UK Government's court, and at the moment, they are not talking to people.
Just to be clear, you've had no contact with the Scottish Government?
Right? Yeah. No, but obviously RSPCA works in England and Wales, sure. So I wouldn't expect to, but okay. I'm very happy to talk to the Scottish Government and look through the evidence and the recommendations that we've given.
Thank you.
I wonder if I could ask a final question in this committee, because it quite often isn't, but we've talked a lot about the resource issues in terms of the government capacity and civil service being distracted. Have any of you done an impact on your own organisations and how much cost and time is having to be diverted to working on rule, given that many of the organisations that you represent as bodies will be charitable in some area?
I can kick off, and I think Isabel mentioned this earlier on. This is a huge distraction to the work that we're already doing. The RSPCA is working on probably 10 different bills within the Senedd and Westminster at the moment to improve animal welfare. And obviously, we are now directing our resources to try and defend the 44 different retained pieces of animal welfare legislation which have been brought over from the EU. I think it's instructive that there are only, as far as we're aware, 3 civil servants working within DEFRA on the 570 environmental and animal welfare pieces of legislation, which now may be over 1,000 because they seem to have discovered some more. And I think that's a real concern. And I know that the Welsh Government is also really concerned about resources because, you know, don't forget, like the Scottish Government, they have an agriculture bill going through, which is the biggest change to agriculture since 1947. And they, rightly so, should be concentrating on improving the standards in agriculture and not being distracted by this. In terms of the RSPCA, yes, of course, this has been a distraction. We've had to put resources to looking at this and try to work out what the legal ramifications are, what is devolved, what is non-devolved, and that is taking a lot of time, which, frankly, as others have said, we should be focused on improving, not trying to retain what we've got at the moment.
Yeah, it goes to Mr. Mackay and to Mr. Austin.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just to agree with everything that Mr. Bowles has just said, the Soil Association is a small charity. We have limited resource, and we have already been discussing how best we can manage this process internally. And that will require us to set aside time and staff time and resource over the duration of next year at least. And that then does distract us from what we consider to be our priorities. And in Scotland, that's about working with Scottish Government through the Agriculture Bill, trying to make the case for a transition to agroecological and nature-friendly farming. It's about pushing for more action. We mentioned earlier targets around the reduction in usage of pesticides. We want to see a big drop in the use of artificial fertiliser on a farm. We want to see more people farming organically. There are all sorts of priorities that our organisation has, and this bill we would not consider to be a priority, but now it has to be. So over the coming months, we will definitely be committing more resource to that. As as has already been said, the UK government and the Scottish and Welsh governments as well.
Mr. Olsen.
Yes, well, from Scottish Link's point of view, we're an umbrella organisation, a forum for over 40 environmental NGOs, which range in size from very large to very small. Link has a small secretariat, but both in Link itself and in all of our member bodies, we would prefer that charitable resource to be devoted to working with Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament on a good agriculture bill, on the Natural Environment Bill, on the Grouse Ball Management Bill, on implementing the climate change plan successfully, etc., etc. Yet we are having to devote resources. I mean, even a number of us being here today is a resource for our organisations on this bill, which is, in our view, unnecessary. And that underlines the fact that we think that the bill is unnecessary and is the wrong way round to address any issues that there are. And, we would very much think that the best way forward would be to withdraw the bill and to do reviews on a sort of topic-by-topic basis in a logical way, in which reviews have been done in the past, and which was the intent in the Withdrawal Act of 2018, which was only a short number of years ago.
Did you want to come in? I know you mentioned it earlier, Ms. Mercer, but...
Yeah, I totally agree with all the comments that have just been made, and I don't want to repeat too many of the things I said earlier, but the constraints on RSPB staff time are also considerable. We have staff working on this at our UK headquarters as well as in each of the devolved countries, and that is quite substantial. And I suppose just to add that a lot of the legislation that Mr. Austin was just outlining and that I mentioned earlier, so the Natural Environment Bill, the Agriculture Bill, legislation on grouse moors. We've also got the new Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, which is currently in development and plans to deliver on the target to protect at least 30% of Scotland's land for 2030. These are the things that we would like to be dedicating our time and resource to influencing and making sure that they can be as much of a success as possible for Scotland. But I'd also highlight that all of those processes are actually opportunities to improve and strengthen existing regulations and laws where the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament see fit to do that through those processes. So, again, I'd just highlight we're not adverse to improving and strengthening the laws that we have, but we just don't feel that this process is going to deliver that.
Mr. McKenzie?
Yeah, at risk of repeating what others have said, but just specifically from my point of view and our organisation, we're a voluntary organisation, we've all got day jobs, so this is a massive distraction and really challenging to even identify all the pieces of legislation that are relevant in terms of the wide remit of things that we do. We'd rather be, and there's a lot going on in our world just now as well, a lot of really good interaction with Scottish Government and Parliament about fireworks, new fireworks legislation, that's all going to fully come in this year. All the cost of living crisis stuff, all of a sudden some of the very basic work we do in terms of measuring things and counting things and pricing things, for example, has suddenly become important. People are complaining about these things now because they're both are struggling financially and there's the perception that they will continue to struggle financially. So there's an awful lot for us to be thinking about. Brexit-related things, in terms of, there's a lot of work for us there in terms of a lot more products coming into the country now are deemed to be imports, whereas they previously weren't. So there's a different regime on the people who are doing that importation. And we need to be tackling that stuff. And it's this is a distraction, as others have said. But, you know, at the same time, this is happening. You know, it's real. So we need to deal with it, you know. So we would certainly hope we're available to contribute to the ongoing conversation, absolutely.
Thank you. I'm looking to see if there are any questions from committee members. Thank you to all our witnesses this morning again, and thank you for written submissions as well. It's been very important to have deliberations on this, and I wish you well for the rest of your day. And on that note, I'm going to move into private session.